Good morning, dear students. So today I'll be continuing with my nutrition part 3. So in my previous class, we had discussed about how to prescribe a balanced diet, and also we had seen what is RQ, what is BMR, what is STA. Okay, so from there I'll continue with that same competency. Today we'll be seeing the different type of diets, how to prescribe a diet in diabetic patients, for a cardiac patient, for in pregnancy and lactation, which are the special conditions. Okay, so let us start my class. Later on we'll move on to the one more competency, that nutritional disorders. Okay, so today I'll be energy malnutrition. Please mute yourself, students. Please mute yourself. So food pyramid. So food pyramid I had already discussed, but just a brief introduction on that. So food pyramid, eating healthy food is essential to have a healthy life and keep strong for one's daily activities. There are different kinds and groups of food that help one body in different ways. So it is important to eat all of them in different amounts every day, so we can get all the nutrients in what one body needs. So in the food pyramid, I group students. Please mute yourself. Are you able to hear me? Please mute yourself. So there are 5 groups in the food pyramid. In the first group, we have to remember that we have to drink plenty of water every day, because the water hydrates our body and helps our organ work properly and cleans our organism from inside. So an adult has to drink 8 glasses of water every day. So coming to the 5 groups in food pyramid, that is group 1, which constitutes the bread, cereals, rice and pastas. So they provide carbohydrates, proteins, fiber, minerals and vitamins. They give us energy, what we need to work, play and all the physical activities every day. There should be 4 servings per day. So this group constitutes the group 1, that is, which constitutes the bread, cereal, rice and pastas. Group 2, it is the vegetables and legumes. So they provide proteins, fibers, vitamins and minerals. So to stay healthy and keep our organism working properly, it helps our organs to work properly. So this should be 4 servings per day. So group 3, it constitutes fruits and vegetables. So vitamin C and folate. Okay, so these are provided with the help of fruits. Okay, so they provide carbohydrates and fiber. It should be 2 servings per day. So coming to the next group, that is group 4, it constitutes the milk, yogurt and cheese. These are the dairy food. So they provide the best sources of calcium. Okay, they provide proteins, vitamin, minerals and fat, and helps our bones grow and stay strong. So they should be 3 servings per day. Group 5, it is the meat, fish, poultry, egg, nuts and legumes. These are the good sources of proteins, fat, vitamins and minerals. So these groups helps our muscles to grow and stay strong. Okay, this should be 2 small servings a day. Last or nothing but the sweets and fats. These are on the top of the pyramid. They provide a lot of energy to our body, but we have to eat only 1 small serving per day. Okay, this is about the food pyramid. There are 5 groups which you have to remember, and you have to remember which groups you have to consume the most and which you have to consume the least. Okay. So dietary goals I have already discussed in my previous class. I'll not go inside in detail regarding this. Coming to the types of diet, okay. So there are conditions under which the above recommendations, like the food pyramid check hold, okay, this does not apply. So, for example, diet in special conditions like pregnancy, lactation, growth period, diabetes. There are different diets prescribed for the patients. Okay, so different type of diets are prescribed to cope up with personal nutritional needs and his or her medical conditions. As already stated, type of diet also depends on various factors. Some types of diets that we may commonly come across are listed below. Please mute yourself, students. Can't you understand? Few of them have unmuted themselves. Please mute yourself. It will disturb the others who are listening. So, the type of diets are South Beach diet, Atkins diet, zone diet, low carb diet, liquid diet, Mediterranean diet, diabetic diet, grapefruit diet, mayo diet. So we'll be discussing regarding diabetic diet, Mediterranean diet and liquid diet. Atkins diet I'll discuss when I take up obesity in my next class. Okay, so I'll just go one by one. So diabetic diet. Okay, so this is an important topic which you have to know. Okay, so management of diabetes gives great emphasis on the dietary goals and exercise. Okay, so the main aim is to keep the blood sugar level as far as near the normal values for as many hours as possible. Okay, so the diabetic diet is prescribed for the weight control, for blood glucose control, prevention and management of short term and term complications of diabetes. So overall blood glucose level may be increased if there is a steep rise in the blood sugar after every meal. So giving a diet having low glycemic index so that the elevation of the blood sugar level is minimum. Okay. So you have to keep the total calories in the small divided, such as breakfast 15%, mid-morning snack 5%, lunch 30%, evening snack 10%, dinner 35%, and bedtime snack 5%. So this is the main goal. You have to supplement the patient in small divided doses. So at least like 5 times a day. So if he consumes all the calories in a single breakfast, though the sugar level will get elevated. That's why we have to give the total calories in a small divided portion. So diabetic diet consists of eat starchy food regularly. He has to have more fruits and vegetables, reduce the animal and saturated fat, cut down on sugars and sweets, okay, reduce the salt intake. So this is the diabetic chart which I told you. Small divided meals has to be planned. The total calories has to be divided in small portions. So I told you juice, he has to have high fiber food. What is the significance of this? It helps to maintain the blood glucose level and cholesterol level. So he has to have more fruits, vegetable, pulses, oats. Okay. So he has to help to maintain a healthy gut. That is by eating whole grain cereals, whole meat bread, pastas, brown rice, it will help him to maintain the healthy gut. Okay. So he has to reduce the animal and saturated fat intake. That is, he has to supplement use of low fat milk, use of low fat spread instead of butter, use oil high in unsaturated fat. Okay. That is, olive oil and rapeseed oil are recommended. But he has to consume the saturated fat to the least. So he has to choose the right sort of fat. We know in which foods we have more saturated fat. So he has to try to reduce those, like butter, cheese, biscuits, okay, chips and all. So fried food items. So monounsaturated fat and polyunsaturated fat is the preferred one. Monounsaturated fat is rich in olive oil, rapeseed oil and groundnut oil. Polyunsaturated fat is rich in the sunflower oil. So he has to make use of this polyunsaturated and vegetable oils he has to use okay, more, but he has to reduce, cut down his intake in the form of saturated fat. So reduce the salt intake. So he has to cut down and added salt, use alternative seasonings, okay, and then he has to avoid the salt substituents. Coming to glycemic index, this is one important topic. So what is glycemic index? Glycemic index is a measure of the effects of carbohydrate on blood sugar levels.
Hello?
So glycemic index may be defined as
Hello?
The area under the blood glucose Hello? Curve after the ingestion of a food compared with the area under the blood glucose curve after taking the same amount of carbohydrate as glucose. Okay, so glycemic index is defined as the area under the blood glucose curve after the ingestion of the food compared with the area under the blood glucose curve after taking the same amount of carbohydrate as glucose. So glucose is taken as a test meal. So it is expressed in percentage. Okay, so simple carbohydrates such as glucose and sugars will always have high GI. However, carbohydrates combined with protein and fat will have a low GI. So glycemic index, this is a definition what I told, that is same thing represented like this: area under the blood glucose curve after ingestion of a test meal by area under the curve after the ingestion are equivalent to glucose. Okay, that is 50 grams of glucose into 100. Okay, this is the glycemic index, how you plot the curve. Okay, this is the low GI foods like beans and this is the high GI foods like glucose. Okay, simple sugars, that is glucose, sucrose, have high glycemic index compared to complex carbohydrates like starch. So glycemic index is high for bread, potatoes, table sugar. It is found to be low in legumes, whole grain cereals. So GI range, it is said to be low when it is 55 or less, medium when it is 56 to 69, high that is 70 or more. Okay, so when the food has more than 70, it is said to have high glycemic index. So we'll see some of the food items which have high and low glycemic index foods. Okay, so you need to remember at least two or three examples for each one of them. So these are the foodstuffs which contain high glycemic index, that is potato chips, bread, white rice, polished. Okay, and parboiled rice has a glycemic index of 60 to 69. Bananas also high, 60 to 69, medium. Okay, and beans and peas has low glycemic index, that is 40 to 49. Milk has 35 to 40. Ice cream, you can see here, it has a low glycemic index food. Okay, so the diabetic patient can take ice creams occasionally. Why? Because the ice cream contains sugar. So it has a low glycemic index because it contains a lot of fat, which prevents absorption. Thus, ice cream may be occasionally consumed by the diabetic patients. Okay. Significance of glycemic index. It is useful in formulating the therapeutic diets for diabetic mellitus patients. Foods with low GI is prescribed for diabetic patients. So always see to it that you recommend low GI foods for your diabetic patients. That is most important so that the blood sugar will be maintained. Coming to liquid diet, a clear or full liquid diet or a diet containing no solid food is often prescribed for a gastrointestinal illnesses or before or after certain types of surgeries involving the mouth or gastrointestinal. It's just, this is nothing but the juice. Okay, you have to give the liquid diet for your patients who are suffering from gastrointestinal illness or who has underwent surgery. Coming to Mediterranean diet. Okay, so Mediterranean diet is a modern nutritional recommendation inspired by the traditional dietary patterns of Spain, southern Italy, Greece, and specifically the Greek island of Crete and parts of the Middle East. So what are the characteristics feature of this Mediterranean diet? There will be high consumption of olive oils, okay, emphasis on consuming monounsaturated fatty acids. So high consumption of fruits and vegetables, bread, cereals, okay, moderate consumption of fish and poultry, moderate consumption of whey, that is 2 or 3 times a week, low consumption of eggs and red meat. So this is the pyramid of the Mediterranean diet. Okay, see here the daily physical activity, after that the bread constitutes lower to the pyramid. It is bread, pastas, rice, okay, whole grains, potatoes a person can consume. Then vegetables, fruits, beans, legumes and nuts. Then olive oil, cheese and yogurts. These foods can be consumed on the day-to-day basis. Okay, fish, poultry, eggs and sweets can be consumed on the weekly basis. Meat, monthly ones. Okay, and daily recommendations to take 6 glasses of water and wine in moderation. So Mediterranean diet pyramid, the things at the bottom should be done or consumed more often. Okay, things at the top should be consumed less often. Okay, that is about Mediterranean diet. So we'll go one by one. So Mediterranean diet and significance with the cardiovascular disease. It reduces the incidence of cardiovascular disease in individuals following the Mediterranean diet. Why is it so? Because this Mediterranean diet consists of consumption of more monounsaturated fatty acids, omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acids. We have seen the advantages of these two in our nutritional importance of lipids. Okay, and there is the person consumes more antioxidants, folic acid, fiber. Okay, and moderate consumption of alcohol. So these are all helps in preventing the cardiovascular risk. Exercise, physical exercise. So it helps in prevention of daily. If the person does the physical exercise, it helps in the prevention of cardiovascular disease and also reduces the risk of death from coronary disease. Okay, he has to eat more whole grains and starchy vegetables. So he has to consume whole grain breads, cereals, rice and pastas. Okay, he can eat potatoes, corn, sweet potatoes, winter squash and other starchy vegetables. He has to consume lots of fruits and vegetables, okay, and have beans, legumes and nut daily. That is but in a watch portion, as it also contains the fat. Small olive oils, cheese and butter can also be consumed in small amounts. Okay, so monounsaturated consists mainly of folic acid. What are the advantage? They inhibit the inflammatory process in the vascular epithelium. So these olive oils reduces the atherosclerosis, okay, hypercholesterolemia and diabetes. That is the advantage of consuming the monounsaturated fatty acids. Omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acids, these are the essential fatty acids. They produce anti-inflammatory eicosanoids that protects the vascular endothelium. They reduce the blood sugar, okay, they improve the lipidemic profile and inhibit the platelet aggregation, and they exert the anti-arrhythmic effects. Okay, these are the advantages of omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acids. This already I told you, weekly he has, once in a week he can consume fish, poultry, eggs and sweet. Monthly ones, meat. Okay, so antioxidants, vitamin E, vitamin C and beta carotene, which are present in the fruits. Okay, folic acid. Okay, so this folic acid is essential for the conversion of homocysteine to methionine. You have seen this in metabolism. Okay, so hyperhomocysteinemia increases the risk for cardiovascular disease. So Mediterranean diet thus reduces the blood homocysteine levels. Fiber. This binds to cholesterol in the intestine and reduces it in the blood. So it reduces the inflammatory markers in the blood. So dietary fiber, he has to consume more dietary fiber in his diet. At least 6 cups of water per day. Use wine in moderation. So alcohol in moderation, what are the advantages? It helps to increase the good cholesterol, that is the HDL cholesterol, and it decreases the LDL cholesterol. It decreases the inflammatory markers and it inhibits the insulin resistance. Okay. So diet works best with, okay, no smoking, moderate daily physical activity and moderate alcohol intake only. Okay, only if you are performing diet and no physical activity, it will not work. So the person has to quit the smoking, okay, and he has to daily exercise, okay, at least 30 minutes of walk. It is recommended that he does 30 to 45 minutes of brisk walk daily, okay, in a week. At least he has to do for 5 days. Coming to diet and cardiovascular disease, okay. So we know that coronary artery disease is a potentially lethal concern, okay. Mortality is very high if timely diagnosis is not made. So underlying defect in this coronary artery disease is deposition of the atherosclerotic plaque on the inner surface of the small or medium sized arteries. So when there is blockage, when occurs in the coronary vessels, it causes damage to the myocardium and results in heart attack. Okay, so if there is blockage of the cerebral blood vessels, it will result in stroke. So the diet has to be formulated. So so the several dietary factors are thought to influence the incidence of or decrease the incidence of coronary artery disease. Okay, so if the person consumes high intake of fat, especially saturated fat, there is it will result in increased amount of cholesterol in the blood, and it will in turn results in the coronary artery disease. So changes to be made in the diet to reduce the risk of coronary artery disease include reduction of dietary intake of cholesterol. Okay, mainly this egg yolk and organ meats are very rich in the saturated fatty acids, and it will in turn increase the cholesterol. So he has to reduce the intake of egg. Okay, in increasing the fish intake because it has omega 3 fatty acids, reducing the salt intake, increase the fruits and vegetables in his diet. Okay, and moderate consumption of alcohol is okay, but not excess. Okay, so increase intake of fibers and antioxidants, and he has to change his lifestyle, that he has to do physical activity. Physical activity is a must. Okay, so to decrease the incidence of coronary artery disease, what has to increase? The HDL has to increase and LDL has to decrease. According to the recent guidelines, LDL cholesterol has to be maintained below 130. Okay, but if there is any risk factor, it has to be maintained below 100 milligram per deciliter. But the woman has protection, okay, because she has higher HDL before menopause, and she is protected from heart attacks. Coming to diet in pregnancy and lactation. So pregnancy and lactation increases the nutritional requirement of the mother in pregnancy because of morning sickness. The food intake is reduced, okay, and she requires the energy for the growth of the fetus. And in lactation, because she is breastfeeding her baby, she requires more calories. So diet in pregnancy, calorie requirement. ICMR nutrition expert group recommends extra allowance of 300 kilocalories per day in pregnant women. So this you have to remember. So calorie intake that pregnant woman should have extra is 300 kilocalories per day. Protein requirement, ICMR recommends an extra allowance of 10 gram per day. It is required for the synthesis of hemoglobin, for synthesis of plasma proteins and formation of tissue proteins. Iron requirement, ICMR recommends 10 milligram per day for enhanced hemopoiesis. Calcium and vitamin D requirement, ICMR recommends an extra allowance of 500 to 600 milligram per day of calcium and 400 IU international units of vitamin D. Okay, so calorie is 300 kilocalories extra she has to consume in pregnancy. Coming to diet in lactation, calorie requirement is ICMR recommends an additional of 700 kilocalories per day for a lactating woman. Okay, so protein requirement is also, she requires 20 gram extra. Okay, calcium is around 500 to 600 milligram per day. Iron requirement is 3.6 milligram of extra iron is required. Vitamin A requirement, an additional of 400 micrograms is required. And these are the requirements of the water-soluble vitamins, vitamin B1, vitamin B2, nicotinic acid, vitamin B12, vitamin C and folic acid. So you have to ask the lactating woman to consume nutritious diet. Okay. Coming to diet and cancer. Okay. So diet influences the risk of certain forms of cancer, like cancer of esophagus, stomach, large bowel, breast and lung and prostate. Okay, high intake of saturated fatty acids are associated with increased risk of cancer, colon, prostate and breast. Food rich in carotenes decreases the risk of many cancers. Vitamin C containing foods protects against stomach cancer, and high fiber diet are associated with reduced risk of colon cancer. Okay, this we are stressing about, so fiber intake will reduce the increase of the incidence of colon cancer. Coming to one last topic under this competency, that is total parental nutrition. Okay, so this may be asked for 5 marks or 2 marks. Okay, so what is this total parental nutrition definition? The intravenous administration of varying combinations of hypertonic and isotonic glucose, lipids, amino acids, electrolytes, vitamins, and trace elements through the venous access device directly into the intravascular fluid to provide nutrients for the patient who are unable to receive adequate nutrition through gastrointestinal tract. So who are unable to eat. Okay, so you are supplementing these hypertonic and isotonic glucose, lipids, amino acids, electrolytes, vitamins through the venous route. Okay, so purpose of this is to provide nutrients required for normal metabolism, repair, and energy demands, and to bypass the GI tracts for patients who are unable to take food orally. So coming to indications, what are the indications when you give this total parenteral nutrition? So patient who cannot tolerate enteral nutrition like paralytic ileus, intestinal obstruction, acute pancreatitis, inflammatory bowel disorder, gastrointestinal fistulas. If a person is severe diarrhea and he has persistent vomiting, malabsorption, in all these cases you can give total parenteral nutrition. Okay, this is one indication that the person who cannot tolerate enteral nutrition. Second indication is hypermetabolic states like severe burns. If a person is nil perorally for more than 5 days, acute renal failure, multiple fractures, tumors in the GI tract. There also you can give total parenteral nutrition. And the patient at risk of malnutrition, that is gross underweight, metastatic cancer. Okay, so these are the indications for the person who cannot take orally, hypermetabolic states, and the patient at risk of malnutrition. So you can write the causes for each one of these. These are the indications for total parenteral nutrition. So methods of parenteral nutrition. So total TNA, that is total nutrient admixture into the central vein. So when you give this patient requiring more than 7 days of parenteral feeding, that time you prefer this method of giving parenteral nutrition, that is TNA, total nutrient admixture. See, this is the TPN, this is the PPN. Okay, so TPN, so how this parenteral formula combines carbohydrate concentration of 20 to 70% extra solution, proteins as amino acids, lipids, emulsions including triglycerides, phospholipids and glycerol, water, vitamins and minerals. All this combination you are providing to the patient through how, say you are preferring the central vein through the superior vena cava. You prefer this condition only if the patient is requiring this parenteral nutrition for more than 7 days. Okay. Second one is peripheral parenteral nutrition. This formula combines carbohydrate, a lesser concentration of glucose solution with amino acids, vitamins and minerals. But here this peripheral parenteral nutrition is given through peripheral veins and is indicated for patients requiring nutrition for less than there. You are preferring a TNA when the patient is requiring for more than 7 days. Here PPN is preferred when it is less than 7 days. So when do you discontinue this total parenteral nutrition? So when the patient satisfies 75% of his or her calorie and protein intake with oral intake or enteral feeding, there is a procedure to discontinue this TPN. So the infusion rate should be halved for 1 hour, halved again the next hour, and then discontinued. Tapering in this manner will prevent the rebound hypoglycemia from hyperinsulinemia. What are the complications of this TPN? Sepsis can occur because you are preferring the vein route, right? So venous access device, if it is contaminated, then it will result in sepsis. Electrolyte imbalance can result, hyperglycemia. Hypoglycemia can occur when there is abrupt disruption or discontinuation of this total parenteral nutrition, okay? And hyperolemia, hepatic dysfunction, hypercardia. These are the complications of total parenteral nutrition. Okay, so you should know the definitions, indications, types and complications. So we'll move on to the next competency. So in this next competency, we'll be seeing the nutritional disorders, that is protein energy malnutrition. So we'll try to classify this protein energy malnutrition. We'll enumerate the causes of this protein energy malnutrition. We'll see the etiology, clinical features, investigation and treatment of kwashiorkor and marasmus. We'll differentiate between kwashiorkor and marasmus. And we'll discuss regarding the treatment for PEM. Okay, so this protein energy malnutrition again is asked for either main question or 5 markers. So coming to nutritional disorder, it is classified into overnutrition or undernutrition. So this overnutrition is common in the affluent urban elite of India, and it is becoming more they are more prone for overnutrition. Okay, so undernutrition, there are two classification. So important nutritional diseases which results from overnutrition is obesity. From undernutrition, malnutrition can occur. Okay, this malnutrition is a state arising from an insufficient calorie intake causing undernutrition. Okay, insufficient intake of either one or more of the essential nutrients and specifically the proteins causing this deficiency. Okay, so this protein energy malnutrition is divided into kwashiorkor and marasmus. So the WHO defines this malnutrition as a cellular imbalance between the supply of nutrients and energy and the body's demand for them to ensure growth, maintenance and specific functions. There is a cellular imbalance between the supply and the use. Okay, so this is the definition for malnutrition. This malnutrition, again we have discussed, is classified into undernutrition and overnutrition. Undernutrition, overnutrition will be seeing in my next class. Undernutrition, there may be growth failure, micronutrient malnutrition and mixed. Under micronutrient, again there will be type 1 nutrient deficiency and type 2. This you need not know in detail, just know the main classification, that is undernutrition and overnutrition. Under undernutrition, that is growth failure can take place. Okay, so this growth failure is again divided into acute or chronic malnutrition, chronic malnutrition, stunting or poor cognitive development, and acute malnutrition, wasting or nutritional edema. So these are the classification under this growth failure. Okay, so what is the etiology of malnutrition? There may be primary malnutrition and secondary malnutrition. There are causes for different. So primary malnutrition, the causes are failure of lactation. Okay, if the lady has not lactated the child, exclusively breastfed her baby for at least 6 months, if the female patient has to breastfeed her baby for at least a period of exclusive breastfeeding is recommended for a period of 6 months and also till 2 years. Okay, with weaning. So ignorance about the knowledge of weaning, starting early weaning and late weaning, that also results in malnutrition. Poverty, cultural patterns and food fads, lack of immunization, okay, and primary care, lack of family planning. Okay, so if the there is no family planning practices and there is no birth spacing between the two childs, then also that will result in malnutrition. Secondary malnutrition results from parasitic infestation, infection, measles, whooping cough, primary tuberculosis, urinary tract infection, congenital heart disease, urinary tract anomalies. Okay, so these are the etiology for primary and secondary malnutrition. So this is globally about 52 million children under 5 are moderately or severely wasted. Okay, so the UNICEF identifies that in developing world, 146 million children under 5 years are malnourished, okay, predisposing them to serious complications from common childhood illnesses. Okay, PM is the deadliest, and it is estimated that it is the primary associated cause of 5.6 million deaths annually. Okay, so goal is by 2025 to reduce and maintain the childhood wasting to less than 5%. See here, you can see here, in global, approximately 162 million children under the age of 5 years are stunted. 40% of children under 5 years are stunted in sub-Saharan Africa. In South Asia, it is 39% of children under 5 years are stunted. So goal is by 2025 to reduce by 40% the number of children aged under 5 years who are stunted. So coming to protein energy malnutrition, so most widespread in developing countries, predominantly in children, so of two types, marasmus and kwashiorkor. So marasmus, it results from a combined severe deficiencies of both dietary energy and protein. Okay, so if a person has inadequate intake of protein and energy, it results in marasmus. Kwashiorkor, sickness of the older child. Okay, so gets when the child gets when the next child is born. It is seen when there is isolated deficiencies of protein with relatively adequate intake of calories. Marasmus results when there is deficiency of both energy and protein. Kwashiorkor results when there is deficiency of protein. So this is the classification of PEM according to WHO. Kwashiorkor, marasmic kwashiorkor, marasmus, nutritional dwarfing and underweight. So body weight of as percentage of standard, when if it is between 60 to 80 and edema if it is present, then it is called as kwashiorkor. If the body weight is less than 60 and edema present and deficit in height, weight for height is also present, then it is marasmic kwashiorkor. In marasmic kwashiorkor, the features of both kwashiorkor and marasmus is seen. In marasmus, the body weight is less than 60 and edema is not present, then it is called as marasmus. Okay. In nutritional dwarfing, the body weight is less than 60, but there is deficit in the weight for height is minimal. Underweight child, when it is between 60 to 80, but there is deficit in the weight for height. So coming to kwashiorkor, kwashiorkor is characterized by the triad of markedly retarded growth, psychomotor changes, okay, then edema. Edema is a characteristic feature of kwashiorkor. What are the characteristics features? Severe edema is associated with hypoalbuminemia. Fatty liver is seen. Hepatomegaly, hair changes, that is thin, dry, this hair is thin, dry, brittle. It is easily pluggable, okay, and sparse and hypopigmented. Flag sign is seen, alternate bands of hypopigmented and normally pigmented skin. When there is alternate bands of this hypopigmented and normally pigmented hair, it is called as flag sign. Flankypan dermatosis, here the hyperpigmented patch is desquamate to expose the raw hypopigmented skin. Infections like diarrhea, respiratory and skin infections are seen in kwashiorkor. So the hallmarks of this kwashiorkor are hypoalbuminemia, poor wound healing and edema. So IgG increases due to the associated infection. Fatty liver is seen in some cases of kwashiorkor. Okay, hypokalemia and hypomagnesemia is seen. Hypokalemia is because of diarrhea. Okay, glucose tolerance is normal. Hypoglycemia may be seen in marasmic child. Okay, what are the causes for edema in kwashiorkor? What is the biochemical finding? Okay, so the biochemical basis for edema in kwashiorkor. The edema is due to the low oncotic pressure in plasma due to hypoalbuminemia. Here, the synthesis of plasma proteins by the liver, that is retinol binding protein, are all decreased. This in turn impairs the export of triglycerides and other lipids from liver, results in fatty liver. Okay, fatty liver is a characteristic feature of kwashiorkor. The edema in the characteristic feature of edema in kwashiorkor, that is, it starts in lower limb and then involves the upper limb and face, and the face is like a moon shape and puffy. Okay, and the psychomotor changes which are seen in this kwashiorkor patient are lethargic. They are lethargic, apathetic. Okay, they have less interest in the environment and does not want to play with toys. Okay, so this is the baby photo of the baby with the kwashiorkor. You can see the edema, moon shaped face, okay, flag sign, okay, the hairs are dry, brittle. Okay, this is also the picture of a baby with kwashiorkor. Okay, moon shaped face. This is a flag sign, I told you, alternate, okay, hypo and normal. This is called as flag sign. This is a flankypan dermatosis. So coming to marasmus, gross wasting of the muscles and subcutaneous tissues result in emaciation and marked stunting. the body weight is less than expected. There is no edema in this marasmus. There is no edema. Okay, when body weight is less than 60%, the fat is severely depleted, but the buccal fat is preserved till the last. And the skin is dry, inelastic, and wrinkles are present. Okay, see, this is a marasmic child. You can see the ribs. Okay, severely wasted muscles, and the hair is hypopigmented, or sometimes there may be alopecia. Abdomen. These muscles are hypotonic. Okay, the marasmic child has a voracious appetite. Okay, so characteristic features of marasmus are growth retardation, anemia, fat, and muscle wasting. This is the marasmic child. Okay, see, severe wasting. Okay, the final fat to be lost is the buccal pad of fat. This is a small hips and thin legs relative to the abdomen. So this is the loss of the buttock fat, okay, and the baggy pants. So marasmic kwashiorkor. Here the severely malnourished child with features of both marasmus and kwashiorkor is seen. Okay, so features of kwashiorkor are edema, pale skin, and hair. So child is unhappy. And signs of marasmus are wasting of muscles of the upper limb, shoulder, and chest. So this is marasmic kwashiorkor, where you can see the features of both marasmus and kwashiorkor. So these are the differences between the kwashiorkor and marasmus. So marasmus always present in a child below 1 year. Kwashiorkor is generally seen between the age of 1 to 5 years when the next child is born. Here the deficiency is in calorie, here it is protein. Cause for marasmus is early weaning and repeated infection. Kwashiorkor, it is starchy diet after weaning and precipitated by an acute infection. Growth retardation is marked in marasmus. The child is irritable and fretful in marasmus, whereas in kwashiorkor he is lethargic and apathetic. Okay. Appearance of a child of marasmus, shrunken with skin and bones. Okay, here the kwashiorkor child has a moon face, edema of the face and lower limbs. Appetite is normal, voracious appetite. Okay, kwashiorkor there is anorexia. Skin is dry and atrophic. Okay, here the crazy pavement dermatosis is seen in kwashiorkor. Here there is no characteristic change, but here there is saw dry, brittle. Okay, plaque sign is seen in kwashiorkor. The serum albumin is between 2 to 3 g/dL in marasmus, and kwashiorkor it is 2 g/dL. Serum cortisol is increased in marasmus, and in kwashiorkor it is decreased. So these are the differences between kwashiorkor and marasmus. So the nutritional indices which are used to assess the protein allergy malnutrition are weight for height, okay, midarm circumference, okay, in the upper arm, and it is a specific indicator for acute malnutrition, height for age and weight for age. What are the complications of protein allergy malnutrition? It is given by the mnemonic shield, that is hypoglycemia, hypothermia, infections, electrolyte abnormalities, dehydration, and deficiency of micronutrients. So these are the complications of PEM: hypoglycemia, hypothermia, infections, electrolyte abnormalities, dehydration, and deficiency of micronutrients. Okay. So when a PEM patient you are treating, you have to focus on all these complications first. These are the investigations which are done in a patient with PEM. Okay, hemoglobin, TLC, that is total leukocyte count, differential leukocyte count, peripheral smear for malaria, for sugar, urea, creat. You'll be measuring the serum proteins and albumin. Albumin will be decreased. I've already told there will be hypoalbuminemia. Urine for routine and culture, stool for cultures, but looking for the reducing substances. Montaux test for tuberculosis, chest X-rays. Okay, HIV screening, liver function test, renal function test are done. Treatment of protein allergy malnutrition. So how do you treat a patient with PEM? So the body response is observed with a diet by providing calories of 150 to 200 calories per kg body weight. So a mixture of three parts of vegetable proteins, that is Bengal gram, and one part of milk protein is found to be very effective. Okay, so laddu can give the Davangere mix. Okay, so by giving proteins, it is monitored by disappearance of edema, rise in serum albumin, and gain in weight. So when you start treating a patient, there will be disappearance of the edema, and there will be rise in the serum albumin, and weight will be increased. So in the first 24 to 48 hours, infection and dehydration is treated first. In the second stage, that is next 7 to 10 days, the diet of 75 kilocalories per kg per day is given and antibiotics. Third stage, more than 10 days, then aim is to restore the patient's protein and fat content. Diet 175 to 200 kilocalories per kg per day for severe malnutrition. Okay? And for moderate, it is 150 kilocalories per kg per day for moderate malnutrition. For treatment of dehydration in case of protein energy malnutrition, we'll use a special ORS. It's called as Rizomol. Okay? So Rizomol is used for treatment of PEM babies. How do you prevent PEM? You have to promote the promotion of breastfeeding practices, okay, and exclusive breastfeeding for a period of 6 months, development of low-cost weaning, nutrition education and promotion of correct feeding practices, family planning and spacing of birth, immunization, food fortification, and early diagnosis and treatment. So this is how you can prevent malnutrition by encouraging them to breastfeed, exclusive breastfeeding for the period of 6 months, and then start weaning. And you have to tell them how to wean, what are the foods they have to give, okay? And they also have to continue the breastfeeding for at least till the child is 2 years old, and they have to space between the child by practicing family planning practices. They have to immunize the child, okay? And early diagnosis and treatment is the way to prevent the PEM. So these are the assignment questions for today. Okay, you have to write and submit it by Saturday. Thank you. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Money is money.